Good evening. My name is Ja'Kai Thomas.
And I'm Mikael Makel.
We are seniors at Frederick Douglass High School. We are the captains of the 2A state football championship winning high school team at Frederick Douglass High School. That was all wrong. I enjoy playing football. My long-term goal is to become a business owner.
I enjoy playing football as well, especially this past season. My long-term goal is to become a graphic designer. Now we want to welcome you to the January 22nd, 2015 Prince George's County Board of Education meeting. Highlights this evening will include the news break, turning computers into careers.
Additionally, under new business, the Board of Education will address the Board Policy 9354, Board Members' Voucher Reimbursements or Expenses, and the PGCPS New Vision, Mission, and Core Values.
Please continue to check www.pgcps.org for upcoming Board of Education meetings and events. And now the January 22nd, 2015 Board of Education meeting will begin.
We are proud seniors at Frederick Douglass High School, and we are ready for college.
I want to give a shout out. One of my cousins is part of this team, Denard Graham. So congratulations. It's my family.
And I think you just embarrassed the boy.
No, he's not embarrassed.
I'm just saying.
Dr. Eubanks, if I may, I got to see them wallop Patuxent.
Yeah.
Dr. Eubanks.
This meeting is getting out of control. We haven't even started yet. Yes, Ms. Williams.
Well, since they're in the proud District 9, I'd like to say that not only do they produce well on the field, this past week they inducted 20 new students in the National Honor Society. So they're doing well in the classroom.
All right, and on that powerful note, good evening. Welcome to the January 22nd, 2015 Board meeting of the Prince George's County Board of Education. And once again, as you can tell, we are so incredibly proud of the champions at Frederick Douglass High School varsity football team. Good job, gentlemen. We of course expect you to win in the classroom just like you went on the field, and I know you're doing that, and we couldn't be prouder. I want to also give a special thanks to the coaching staff. Is Coach Pinkney and Coach Sutton out of there? Coach Pinkney? All right. All right. We know, like the teachers and the coaches and the counselors, it's the guidance, it's the love, it's the prodding, especially on that football field, it's the driving these young men to achieve that makes a big difference. And so your accomplishments are very much appreciated. Thank you, gentlemen, for your leadership.
Thank you. Dr. Eubanks, are you finished with Douglass?
I was going to try to have agenda, but
I just wanted to recognize the outstanding principal, Eddie Scott, who's here with them as well.
Oh, absolutely. I didn't see Mr. Scott.
And Rudy Saunders, former principal from there, and Monica Golson, former principal from Douglass High School.
All right. That's fine. Anybody else we missed from Frederick Douglass? Oh, parents of Frederick Douglass. All right, parents. All right, that's what I'm talking about. All right. And before we really break out in a game or something here, let's get this meeting started. And I'm going to please ask Ms. Quinteros Grady to lead us in the board prayer and pledge of allegiance.
Oh God, we pray to administer that which is just in all educational policies, being ever mindful of your guidance, steer us to action with love, wisdom, and understanding. Amen.
flag for the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Mrs. Berkeley, would you please call the roll?
Yes, sir. Good evening, board members. Dr. Anderson? Mr. Burroughs?
Present.
Ms. Epps? Ms. Eubanks?
Here.
Ms. Hernandez? Ms. Jacobs?
Here.
Dr. Kaufman?
Here.
Ms. Mundy?
Present.
Ms. Quinteros Grady?
Present.
Mr. Valentine?
Here.
Mrs. Williams?
Here.
Mr. Taylor?
Present.
Ms. Boston? Dr. Eubanks.
Present.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. All right, board members, may I please have a motion to adopt, or do you want to make a motion?
I move to have the non-agenda item public speakers be moved to the public, to the agenda item public speakers.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed? That motion carries. So may I have a motion to adopt the January 22nd, 2015 board meeting agenda as amended?
Second.
It has been moved and seconded. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed? That motion carries. Colleagues, may I please have a motion to adopt, to approve the January 8, 2015 board meeting and January 20, 2015 budget work session minutes? It has been moved and seconded. Is there any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed? Thank you. We're now going to have our news break, turning computers into careers.
We're not professionals here, guys. Not yet.
A wobbly robot notwithstanding, the sophomores in High Point High School's Computer Science Academy are getting more and more professional every day. In the second year of what is destined to be a four-year program, the aspiring technicians are hoping that their keystrokes to make little Finch weave and even whistle will eventually lead to the job of their dreams.
Why should I hire you?
Because I want to be the best. I'm going to strive to be the best in computer science.
So you think you can be the best? You think you can be better than the rest of the people who work for me? What can you do that you think the other ones can't do?
I'm going to design my own program and stuff like that.
Karan and his classmates' job prospects took a quantum leap recently as Microsoft and the Maryland State Superintendent came to High Point to announce a windfall for students there and indeed those across the county and throughout the state.
Microsoft will provide a one-year license for Microsoft IT Academy programs to 25 high schools in 10 counties across the state of Maryland, including High Point High School.
We're very pleased to partner with MSDE to arrange for all students at public schools in the state to receive Microsoft Office 365 at no additional cost. This provides the opportunity for every student in Maryland Public School to download Microsoft Office and up to 5 PCs or Macs, including Office on mobile devices, enabling them to get their schoolwork done virtually at any time and from anywhere.
You can see what it looks like to interface with the website. So again, you just go to MarylandAccess.education.
Tell me what it is that this new initiative, Microsoft Pro 365, is going to mean to you, because for you and every kid in Maryland, it's now going to be free.
I mean, for me, I didn't have Microsoft Office at first. So when I heard about this, I was actually pretty happy, seeing how I could actually work on like studying, say, for whatever I'm trying to know, because typing out on stuff like Notepad isn't really the easiest thing to work with.
And while the waiving of Microsoft's $99 internet broadband access fee is a boon to students, even better is the prospect that High Point's new IT Academy will provide an industry-recognized credential that they'll earn right along with their high school diploma.
So in this case, it's the Microsoft Technology Associate, or MTA, certification. Right, and there's three different opportunities there. One in computer software design, one in IT infrastructure, and also database design. You know, we're very fortunate here to have three examples of students from High Point High School here who have made the decision, you know, through their freshman year, now in their second year, to focus on computer science and IT. And as the statistics that Principal Jimenez mentioned, you're on a very good path for a job. So I look forward to watching you and seeing you grow going forward.
Mr. Harper's employment offer did not go unnoticed by the students in the room, even if certification is still a few years away.
Are you thinking about maybe going into this as a career?
Yeah. I really like Microsoft and I'm planning to work with them. So I really want the computer science degree.
Did you let these guys here know this morning you'd like to work for them?
No, but I'm planning to tell them later.
Good idea. Is that part of your thinking here? Would you like to get some really top-notch young people in the pipeline to advance the good work that you're doing already?
Absolutely. You know, that's one of the big challenges that we have, not just in the state of Maryland, but across the country, right, is to get very, very good graduates, both in computer science and technology. Industry has a huge need for these graduates and these skills. And, you know, we don't have enough of them. So our goal is to come as early as we can to get exposure and training on technology.
The new Microsoft Technology Associate credential, along with others offered in Prince George's schools, like a computer repair and operating certificate, licenses for nursing, fighting fires, and handling food, and employment-ready trade certificates for carpenters and plumbers, all are validating students' career and college readiness. And while learning, like High Point's little robot, may occasionally go around in circles, with so many great training opportunities, Prince George's youngsters can't help heading in the right direction.
This is really going to mean something substantive for these students. They're going to have the career opportunities that they can get a job right out of high school, and that's going to help them get also the college, because they'll be able to partner with businesses to be able to help them maybe pay for college or reimburse them for college, or even pay for their own college if they are able to graduate from high school and get a good job where they can afford their own college. So either way, they get career and college at the same time. This is a win-win.
This is Dave Zarin reporting.
All right, let's give him a hand. I need some of them young folks to just follow me around and teach me how to use my iPhone. I'll be in good shape. All right, folks, let's move on to the chair's report. We will begin, as we always do, remembering those who we love, who we care about, who move on. And I want you to please join me in a moment of silence for Mr. Wilson L. Mosby, the father of Antonia Robinson, an administrative assistant for the Office of Teaching and Learning, and for Mr. Bobby Clements, who happens to be my cousin. If you could join us in a moment of silence, please. Thank you so much, friends. Thank you. All right, a few notes. I love the more my staff who writes some of this stuff for me is so eloquent. As we encounter the many signs of winter, you all know I will never speak like that. When it starts to snow and sleet and you slip and fall in your driveway, please be careful. So please do be mindful and diligent and stay abreast of our calendar for any closures, late arrivals, or early dismissal notices. All of these are posted on our website. I know many of our schools, like mine, we get texts and all kinds of notices, so please just be sure that you pay attention to those, and families, please be patient with us. Dr. Maxwell will tell many stories about the 4 a.m. phone calls that we need to make those decisions and drive the roads and try to rely on all kinds of conflicting forecasts. And so we do the best we can, obviously, with the primary goal of keeping our students safe. So please do pay attention to those things and take a look at our website and for any alerts and any changes. Let me give some kudos to some students. Congratulations to Chioma Ike from Dr. Henry A. Wise Jr. High School, who recently was named Student of the Week. One of your buddies?
Yes.
All right. All right. Chioma has been on the honor roll every quarter of her high school career. She scored a 4 on the AP World History exam and is a member of the National Society of High School Scholars. She participated in the Nikki Giovanni Poetry Workshop and also volunteers at her church. Chioma has applied to the University of Maryland College Park, UMBC, Towson University, Howard University, St. John's University, and Mount St. Mary's University, and I'm sure she will have numerous options in just a few months. And she hopes to, plans to major in biology and become a pediatrician with her own practice. All right. A couple of notes. She'll take care of my grandbabies, maybe. Reminders of upcoming board meetings. We'll be conducting a series of meetings to review the CEO's proposed FY 2016 operating budget. And we have some public input and public hearings regarding that. So on January 27th at 5 o'clock, we'll have a budget work session here in the boardroom. As a reminder to board members, it is an open and public meeting, but we will have it in the back room so we can engage in some deep dialogue about it. And then we'll be out here at 7 p.m. For an operating budget public hearing. And then we will do it all over again at both 5 and 7 p.m. on February 10th. On February 12th, 2015, at 1 o'clock, we'll have a system oversight operating and support services meeting. And on February 24th at 7:05, we'll have a board meeting, and we may be announcing a special location. We've been talking for a while now about taking one of our board members, one of our board meetings, out to one of our schools, and we hope to do that as soon as February 24th. If we don't get it done then, we'll get it done real soon. A reminder, persons interested in speaking at meetings must register with the office 2.5 hours prior to the meeting by calling 301-925-6115. And before I conclude and turn over to Dr. Maxwell, I'd like to yield a portion of my time to my friend and colleague, Curtis Valentine, to talk about some tremendously exciting work and that he has coming up on February 12th.
Thank you, Dr. Eubanks. On February 11th, Wednesday at 6 o'clock, I would have called you before you got, make sure you were there. Last year, I organized some fathers in our school system to celebrate the good work that we are currently doing, but also to encourage other fathers to get more involved in our school system. The data is clear that when students have involved fathers, they're 42% more likely to get A's, 33% less likely to be left back in school, and 98% more likely to graduate on time. So last June, we honored about 50 fathers in our school system. We organized a forum where we had other fathers talk about how they're getting involved in their schools, but also with their children at home. And that event was very successful. We decided to do it again this year, but do it twice a year as opposed to just once. So this February 11th at 6 o'clock at Flowers High School, we will organize our mid-year Fathers Forum where we will celebrate the good work that fathers have done in our school system over the first and second semesters. We will honor, we're looking to honor every a father from every school. So currently we have about 50 fathers who have been nominated, but between now and next week we're looking for all the other principals who have not nominated a father to do so as soon as possible to email Aisha Berkeley in my office to nominate a father who's doing outstanding work in your school. So once again, I'm making a call out to all those principals who have not nominated a father to please do so as soon as possible so that we can celebrate the good work that we see in parental engagement in our system, but most importantly, how we encourage fathers to get more involved, because I believe it's the way to improve academic achievement and create system success. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Valentine. That concludes my chair's report, and I now yield the floor to Dr. Maxwell for his report.
Good evening. Thank you, Dr. Eubanks. I have just a few items this evening. One of the first items you'll learn in management training is that all organizations are made up of people, and it is the people who make the organization what it is. Tonight, I'd like to recognize and welcome a few new people. Who make our team great. First, I'd like to congratulate James Richardson, principal of Buck Lodge Middle School, who was named 2015 Digital Principal by the National Association of Secondary School Principals. He is one of. Thank you. He is one of only three principals in the country to receive this honor for his work in improving instruction and student achievement through the integration of digital media. Principal Richardson will be recognized for this achievement at the National Association of Secondary Schools Principals Conference in San Diego next month. I'd like to extend my congratulations to Mr. Richardson and the entire team at Buck Lodge Middle School. Next, I'd like to welcome Cherie Johnson to the Prince George's County Public School family. Would you stand up, Cherie, so everyone can see you? Cherie is our new public information officer, working with her colleagues in the Office of Communications. Cherie will help tell our district story with multiple stakeholders in the county and across the region and serve as our lead spokesperson. Cherie comes to us most recently from the Harford County Council, and I'm delighted she has joined our team. Welcome. Finally, told you I'd be brief. Finally, the state of Maryland welcomed our new governor, Larry Hogan, yesterday afternoon. As many of you know, the budget process for our district is well underway, and we are monitoring the General Assembly and the governor's budget outlook, particularly the GCEI funding formula, very closely. One critical component of our budget process is input from our parents, families, and the community. I hope, as Dr. Eubanks mentioned, to see participation at our upcoming public hearings on Tuesday, January 22nd, 7th, and January 27th, and Tuesday, February 10th at 7 p.m. in this room, and at other appropriate hearings and meeting places at the county and state levels. Thank you, and this concludes my report for the evening.
Thank you very much, Mr. Maxwell. I'll yield the floor now to Associate General Counsel Demetria Tobias for our legislative report.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Good evening, everyone. You have a copy of the legislative report, so I won't go over each bullet point or item by item. I'll just highlight a few things for you, and I'll actually start with a budget update, some information that we have for you that we just learned this afternoon that's not reflected in your report. So I'll provide you with that quick budget update and then explain some recommended bill positions that the policy committee reviewed and recommended from last week's meeting. So first, starting with the budget, as Dr. Maxwell mentioned, our Governor Hogan was inaugurated on yesterday, and he provided an outline of his proposed budget today to General Assembly leadership and to the press. We haven't actually seen the plan, which is going to be released to the legislature on tomorrow, but based on the outline, here is what we know. The budget for next fiscal year will be $16.4 billion. And state aid to schools will be $6.1 billion of that funding. That represents about a $45 million increase. As you know, we've been focusing on GCEI funding, which is approximately about $40 million for our school system this year. And based on the governor's proposal, he is going to be cutting GCEI funding in half across the board. So for our system, that can mean that easily is a $20 million cut. In addition, the governor appropriated or has recommended the appropriation of $290 million for the public school construction program. But as you know, that's money, that's the state pot, not the Prince George's pot per se. And so we don't know yet what impact that will have on our county's capital improvement program. I know that our staff is working on the numbers there. In addition, there's another budget category called the net taxable income, which has been essentially like a supplemental grant for our jurisdiction and a few others that has been phased in incremental levels over the last few years. We have currently been funded at the 60% level, and our understanding is that the NTI appropriation will be frozen for next year, so we will not receive the expected bump up to 80%. For next fiscal year. And then lastly, there's another factor, which is called the inflationary factor, which changes annually. And our understanding is that that factor will be frozen next year and that the next bump would actually happen for fiscal year 17. So as you can imagine, it's certainly not as bad as it could be, but it's not the greatest news in the world, because this is real money for our system, and our folks are working diligently to figure out what this is actually going to mean in terms of the impact to programs and everything that we have going on. So at the state level, I'm going to be monitoring very closely the subcommittee hearings, the meetings, the briefings, as the House begins to do its work on passing the budget. I just want to say that this truly is a process, and it's going to be, it's going to be busy, but it's a process. And so the legislature cannot add to the governor's budget, nor can they move money between categories, but they can reduce and they can restrict. So it's an interesting checks and balances here to see what the final product will be. But as we're looking at the details, just released this afternoon, they are sobering, but we're going to be monitoring everything very carefully. So moving on to the bills that I wanted to bring to your attention tonight, as I mentioned, the policy committee met last week, and we discussed seven bills, three of which we're bringing to the board's attention on today. As I explained in the report, there are four bills that we're holding for various reasons to either do some additional research or to reach out to the bill sponsors to talk about potential amendments. So those are not ready for a vote before the entire board on today. But the bills that we wanted to bring to your attention are, the first one is PG 40615. This is Delegate Valentino Smith's bill on requiring the board to adopt a policy on the use of school property for non-educational uses. The bill does not specify which uses to which it applies, but as we have spoken with the delegate and heard in public hearings, this has been an attempt of hers to respond to some concerns of her constituents about cell phone towers on school property and just the whole process for approving and reviewing those. When we met with the committee, they are recommending for us to oppose this bill, primarily because the board already has both a policy and the administration has an administrative procedure that has quite a bit of detail about the criteria used for the approval of telecommunications facilities on school property. So if that truly is the intent, we already have, we have policies and procedures to address that. Certainly, if there is a need to either, expand current language or just to have a conversation about whether or not we need to do more, we're open to that conversation, but the committee's view is that a bill is unnecessary, and for that reason, they have recommended that you oppose PG 40615. Moving on to the next bill, we're going to hold 40715, the turf fields bill. We're working on talking with the bill sponsor about some potential amendments, so we will bring that to you as soon as possible. We are also holding PG 40815. This is the bill regarding the participation of county-based businesses and essentially having a having goals for minority minimum percentage of procurements that would go to these businesses. Local, county-based businesses, not MBEs, thank you. And so we're working with our Director of Purchasing and Supply Services to see whether or not there's some amendments that we can do on our internal policies that would really mean that the bill would be unnecessary. So that will be back to the committee shortly. So that will not be before you on a vote today. The next bill for your vote would be PG 40915. This is Delegate Washington's bill, and it would require the board to establish specific criteria for the evaluation of school buildings and facilities in the county. There are several, there was a list of at least half a dozen or so factors that the bill wanted the board to consider. And as I mentioned at your last meeting, the bill is laudatory, but it's unnecessary because you've already contracted for a much more comprehensive master plan that's going to be before you in May of this year, and I believe ultimately sent to the state in July. So the bill is just simply unnecessary, and for that reason, the committee is recommending for you to oppose it. The next bill that we discussed, but for which there was no position, was PG 41115, and that was Delegate Washington's bill that would prohibit the Board of Education from using or having credit cards. Second to the last bill that the committee discussed is PG 41215. This was the Alternatives to School Suspension Pilot Program. At the time of our meeting, we still didn't have a copy of the bill text available for the committee's discussion. I checked online today, and the text is finally available, so that will be brought to the committee for its February 5th meeting. So that's on hold. And then the last bill, just for your information, that's on hold, is PG 41315. This is the New School Construction Investment Act. And this would impose a 1% sales tax increase in Prince George's County for the purpose of raising revenue for major renovations or replacement of school facilities. There's a lot of additional research we need to do on this bill and talking to some of our counterparts to see their positions as well. And so currently that bill is on hold. So just to repeat, the two bills for your consideration and vote this evening are for PG 40615, and that's the use of development of a policy for the non-educational use of school property, and PG 40915, and that is developing criteria for building surveys and inspections. And that's all I have.
Thank you. I have Mr. Burrows and then Mr. Valentine.
Hi.
Hi.
You mentioned that you're recommending that we take positions on two bills.
Yes.
And what I'm suggesting is that the full board take a position on each of the bills listed, including the ones the board should concur on whether we want to hold or take no position, or if we want to take a position or not on all of the bills, right? Because the committee might feel like we should hold or not take a position, but that shouldn't stop members from having their voices heard based on how they feel about each of the bills.
Sure. Well, I'll defer to the chair on that.
So you are well within your right to make a motion so you're recommending that the motion isn't just for those two bills, but that we make a motion to support all of...
No, not to support.
To support the recommendation of the committee on each of these bills.
No.
Okay.
To take a position on each of these bills. I believe the board can see what the committee recommendation was, but we can take each bill, discuss it, and then let the board determine whether or not it wants to concur with the committee or not.
That's the will of the board, but anyone can also make a motion to accept the recommendations of the committee.
I hear you.
Mr. Valentine.
Thank you. Just to my colleague's point, as I'm understanding the presentation, the hold is based on you seeking out more information. We can understand that you would come back with a recommendation to oppose or support, and at that point in time,
or to take no position.
Sure. The board would have that discussion. So we're not having the discussion. We're just not having it now because your advice, someone who does this every day, and someone we hired to do this for us, and who is in Annapolis every day, is saying that in order for you to give us a good recommendation, that there's more information that you want to give, and I accept that. My point was, and I'm beginning to sound redundant, and I asked the same question 2 weeks ago, have you received any more engagement from these bill drafters before they've drafted them with regard to the school system? My concern is a lot of the bills that I'm hearing coming out of the legislature are bills that have been drafted without consultation from the school system, because if we're having you tell us that the bill is unnecessary because we're already doing it, it's telling me the bill drafter did not consult with us. So has that changed over the last 2 weeks? Are we still in a position where we have our legislators drafting legislation without prior consultation with the administration?
For the most part, we haven't been consulted in advance on most of these bills. I will say this, though. Sometimes we give the information, and the legislator still wants to drop the bill. And obviously, it's in their right to do that. But of the seven, for example, that are the seven local bills that we're discussing tonight, I think we were given a heads up on two. And so once we learn of them, we reach out to the delegate to provide some more information to figure out, whether or not, we can provide sufficient information essentially to get the bill withdrawn. I mean, we're doing the work once we learn of it, but usually, at least in this case, we haven't learned of five of the seven until they were actually introduced.
Thank you. And to the previous point, Chairman Eubanks, I would continue to concur with our counsel and say that I would prefer to vote on the two bills she recommends and then to wait for additional information before voting on bills that she has recommended us to hold.
Thank you. Is that a motion? Is that a motion, Mr. Valentine?
Yes, that's a motion.
So it's been moved to concur with with counsel and with the policy committee to oppose the two bills that that have been recommended. Is that?
Yes, sir.
Right. Okay. Do I have a second?
Yes.
All right. It's been moved and seconded. That motion is on the floor for discussion. Dr. Anderson.
Mr. Valentine made the point that I wanted to make, that we will be in a position to make an informed decision by the next board meeting.
Yes.
Thank you. Dr. Kaufman?
Just one question. I didn't hear you say anything, and I may have just missed it, about 407-15, the turf fields bill. And I just wanted to know if that comment there about being on hold, does that stand in terms of waiting for a meeting, or has there been any change?
Yes, it does. We have a meeting scheduled with Delegate Walker on next week, and we're gauging his openness to some amendments that we discussed in the meeting. Okay. And so we'd like to bring those back to the policy committee.
Okay. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Burrows.
Which two bills are you recommending that the board take position on tonight?
PG 406-15 and PG 409-15.
All right. I would suggest that PG 411-15, that no position is actually a position. The board agreeing not to get involved, not to definitively decide one way or the other, is a decision. And I would hope that we would be very public and deliberate about our response to PG 411-15.
So are you, number one, that's either a separate motion or are you recommending an amendment to the current motion?
I'm not certain if the maker of the motion is going to be willing to have this discussion on this item. So
So you could.
I don't want to put you on the spot.
Your choices are: you could do that, or we could vote for this, and then you could make a motion.
Well,
whatever.
I mean, the maker of the motion just raised his hand. Are you willing to allow the discussion on the credit card bill?
Well, no, that's not that. The question is: do you want a friendly? So you're asking him: does he have a friendly amendment to add PG 411.15 to his motion?
That's exactly what I'm asking.
Is that? Do you consider that friendly?
Before I do that, I would just ask the council to give us her rationale for why she decided to issue no position as opposed to oppose.
So, and to be clear, the committee did that.
Okay, the policy committee did
that's
that.
Correct.
Okay. Well, in that case, I would not accept that as a friendly amendment.
All right, so we're still on the motion then for the two that we have. Is there any further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor of approving, of supporting the policy committee's recommendation to oppose bills number 406 and 409, please say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed? That motion carries. Mr. Burrows, you want to make your motion?
Yes, I move to support PG 411-15.
Let me make clear on that. Are you moving to support the recommendation that we take no position? Or
no. I'm moving that the board supports the bill. Instead of taking no position, I'm moving that the board supports the bill.
Got it. Is there a second?
Point of clarification.
Sir?
Council, it's my understanding that what we just took does say that the board is going to take no position on that?
No, the motion was to accept the recommendation of the committee to oppose two specific bills. That was it.
Okay.
So there's a motion on the table to support 411.15. It has been moved and seconded. Is there any discussion?
So I can second?
Yes,
Mr. Taylor.
Does this fall under budget? Am I allowed to vote on this?
Yes, you can.
No, you are not the council.
Yes.
Hold on, let's let council answer the question.
This is legislation you're talking about, so yes, you can vote on it.
Thank you.
But good answer, Mr. Burrows.
You have the correct answer.
So if I...
Wait a minute. I got Ms. Mundy, and then I have Ms. Grady.
Thank you. I have two questions. My first question, Mr. Bias, is what two bills did you have previous discussions about prior to the bills coming out that you just mentioned with the drafters? And how, if you've met with them, how were those discussions? How did they end up? Were they willing to rescind them, or did they defend them, or give you a perspective about where they were coming from, and how did those discussions go?
Sure. Okay, so the two bills that we heard about in advance of their introduction were 406.15, the school property bill. Delegate Valentino Smith reached out to Dr. Maxwell, myself, Dr. Eubanks. She spoke to several folks in the administration just to find out, first of all, what policies and procedures we have to address her constituents' concerns and basically to find out, is there someplace where we have, you know, explicitly written what she's looking for in this bill?
And she wasn't as satisfied.
With what we gave her.
Okay. And the second one was,
One was Turfields, 407. That's a reintroduction from last year, this might even be the third year. So Delegate Walker has been in pretty regular contact, I know, with Ms. Battle and Dr. Maxwell's office. And so we've had conversations with him about certain aspects of the bill, but not everything. And so there are some specific amendments about which we want to meet with him to see whether or not he'd be open to our suggested changes.
Okay, thank you.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not important how many times it has come up.
All And now, for questions regarding to the motion on the table, you have Ms. Green?
Right. I was actually going to second.
Oh, it's been seconded already.
Oh, okay. Well, thank you.
It's been moved and seconded. Is there any further debate on this? Seeing none. Ms. Mundy.
I just had a quick question, a question for clarity. So the position of no position on 411-15 was set forth by the policy committee on behalf of the whole board? That's my question. I wasn't sure about
the policy committee makes recommendations to the board, which is what we're doing right here. So the policy committee recommended a no position on a discussion based on the fact that we ought to be resolving this in our own policies and not in legislation. And that was in process. So that was where the recommendation from the policy committee came from, a position of taking no position. That was the gist of that discussion. So now, Dr. Kaufman.
I just wanted to say for the record, I'm going to be voting no on this motion, but that it's not because I'm taking a, you know, as a position on the question, the substance of issuance of credit cards or not. To the chair's point, I think it's a matter that's better resolved by this board rather than legislation. Just wanted to say that.
Thank you. All right. I said your light was on, but you could. All right. So the motion is a move to support, excuse me, 411-15. I've heard some debate on this, so why don't we call the roll on this?
Motion to support the recommendation. Motion to support the bill, PG 411-15. Dr. Anderson?
No.
Mr. Burroughs?
Aye.
Ms. Epps? Ms. Eubanks?
No.
Ms. Hernandez? Absent. Ms. Jacobs?
Aye.
Dr. Kaufman?
No.
Ms. Mundy?
I vote no.
Ms. Quinteros Grady?
I vote yes.
Mr. Valentine?
No.
Ms. Williams?
No.
Mr. Taylor?
Yes.
Ms. Boston?
No.
Dr. Eubanks?
Abstain.
We have 4 yes, 7 no, 1 abstain, 2 absent.
Okay, that motion fails. Ms. Boston.
I would like to make a motion to support the no position on Bill 411, is it -15?
Yes. So on the table, support no position on 411-15. Is there a second? It's been moved and seconded. Mr. Burroughs.
You know, I'm going to respect the will of my colleagues, but I will say this. We've spent months and months debating the credit card policy. We've been in every newspaper, on every TV channel. For me, I believe that it's a law would allow us to focus on our work. I'm tired of having the discussion. I'm tired of having the debate of if members should have credit cards or not. Having a codified law in place would allow us to focus on what actually matters. And I think we spent too much time in debate over this issue. I respect my colleagues and the decision that you've made, but it was important for me to let you know where I stand on the matter.
Ms. Jacobs, and then Dr. Anderson.
Yield to Dr. Anderson.
Dr. Anderson.
I appreciate the position from Mr. Burroughs on this issue. I want to stress, though, that we're going to be addressing it locally, and I think that's the better place.
You still, Ms. Jacobs?
Thank you. I think that, you know, this board is in compliance with the law right now, and this board will be in compliance with the law if it changes. And so, with all due respect to my colleague as well, I would say that I agree. We have to focus on the work. And to the extent that media can drive decision-making of legislators, regardless of whether or not it's factual or not, takes us off course. So it's in the best interest of children to make sure that we govern ourselves. As I said, we are obeying the law now and we'll obey it if the law passes. But again, to the extent that we have legislators who are making those kinds of decisions based on those kinds of reports, I think we need to move on.
Dr. Kaufman.
Thank you. Just at the risk of further extending this debate, which we all would prefer not to be engaged in, I fully agree with my colleague Sendman, who voted yes on the last motion, that this is not the issue that we want to be focused on, and that there are many, many more important issues. What I'm concerned about is the precedent of delegating our decision-making authority to the legislature over this issue, as well as other issues that might come along that we can't envision at this moment, where we feel like we as a Board of Education have the primary authority to handle them. And so for me, it's not just about this issue per se, but it's about, generally speaking, our relationship with the legislature, and we have to be conscientious about that. Thanks.
Mr. Valentine.
Just to clarify, this bill was dropped actually last year as well, prior to the media story about the Board of Education's use. I'm sorry, the bill was not dropped last year?
It was dropped last year, but
the bill was based on.
Okay, it was dropped last year prior to the recent news around the Prince George's County Board of Education, just to clarify.
So I'll jump in and let me just say that I've had numerous conversations with board members about this. We have developed a new policy that's on first reader. The board office has implemented some policies based on my request that would all but eliminate any need for credit cards in the first place. And I certainly hope and expect that we will move away from credit cards in our own policy in the very near future. And that we take control of our own destiny and do what I think was the right thing to do anyway, and not ask the legislator to do it for us. I see no other people to speak. Ms. Berkley, please call the roll.
Motion to support no position on Bill PG 411-15. Dr. Anderson?
Aye.
Mr. Burroughs?
No.
Ms. Epps? Absent. Ms. Eubanks?
Aye.
Ms. Hernandez? Absent. Ms. Jacobs?
Aye.
Dr. Kaufman?
Aye.
Ms. Mundy?
Aye.
Ms. Quinteros Grady?
No.
Mr. Valentine?
Aye.
Ms. Williams?
Aye.
Mr. Taylor?
I'd like to abstain from the vote.
Ms. Boston?
Aye.
Dr. Eubanks?
Aye.
9 ayes, 2 nays, 1 abstain, 2 absent.
That motion carries. Ms. Boston?
If I'm not out of line for this motion that I'm getting ready to present, but I would like to move for the board at this point to actually take a vote on the credit cards. I think since this issue is present with us right now, I don't see why we can't go on and finish this discussion and go on and vote on the credit card issue.
So that's not in order currently at the time, Ms. Boston. However, I believe we're on a first reader for a policy that pertains to that, and when we get to that agenda item, you would be able to pull that and recommend a change.
Thank you.
Any other discussions about legislative items?
That is it for this evening.
Thank you for that wonderful report.
Thank you. Thank you.
All right. Now let's have some fun discussions. I'm going to, that was a blast. I'm going to yield the floor to Dr. Maxwell for an introduction of the discussion item 4.1 on the Wallace Principal Pipeline Initiative.
Thank you, Dr. Eubanks. I'd like to defer or refer or pass this off to Dr. Monique Davis.
All right. Thank you, Dr. Maxwell. I yield the floor. Should I say tag you're it? This week, we recognize not only the work of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., but our president gave his State of the Union address as well, and our new governor was sworn in office. But ironically, my inspiration this week didn't come from any of the April Mission events, but really from a McDonald's bag. DJ had to be at school early one morning this week, and we stopped by McDonald's for breakfast. And on the bag, part of their advertisement says, grow your own. We do. 67,000 restaurant managers worldwide start out as crew. Grow your own. And that's what our topic is today, about growing our own. Mm-hmm. As our board and CEO collaborate and strategize to increase student achievement, we know that leadership is second only to teaching among school influences on student success, and its impact is greatest in schools with the greatest needs. This quote is grounded in Dr. Kenneth Leithwood's research and acknowledges the importance the role of leadership has in shaping and developing educational lives of our students. In 2011, Prince George's County Public School System was fortunate to be only one of six recipients nationwide to be awarded the Wallace Principal Pipeline Initiative grant. And at that particular time, it was the largest private grant that our county has ever received, with $12.5 million awarded to our county over 5 years. For the purposes of tonight, we will provide contextual data. Then we'll walk you guys through each of the four components that the grant stipulates. One, defining leadership through our leader standards. We're gonna also talk about high quality pre-service training, selective hiring process, and evaluations and on-the-job support. The grant also requires us to consider the alignment, capacity, and quality assurance of our work. We will also look at the impact of change the grant has afforded us. We are currently in the third phase of this grant, and next month we'll move into the fourth phase. Consider us beyond the midpoint of our success, but what is important is that we do take stock of not only what we learned, but also to celebrate our successes, but most importantly, talk about some of our challenges and next steps as we update you on our Wallace Pipeline Initiative grant, as we in Prince George's County work on growing our own. It is my pleasure at this time to turn over the presentation to Doug Anthony, our Executive Director in the Office of Talent Development.
Thank you, Dr. Davis. Good evening, board members. Appreciate you.
Good evening.
Hearing our presentation this evening. Before I get started, I think it's important that I first just, again, thank you all for this opportunity to present. I also want to thank Dr. Maxwell and Dr. Davis for their unwavering support of this monumental effort. I'd be remiss, though, if I didn't take the opportunity to acknowledge all the people and offices that are significant to the successful implementation of the grant to date. So if you would, I'd ask for your indulgence as I recognize a few of them with us here tonight. So, friends, as I identify you or your office, would you please stand and be recognized? Pamela Shetley, the director, and the entire OTD staff, which includes our Wallace Prince George's County team, Daryl Haley in the Grants Fiscal Management Office. I believe Claire and Crystal are also here. Bob Gaskin in the Division of Human Resources, including Debbie Sullivan, the Strategic Workforce. I know Bill Ryan is not here, but everyone in Human Resources. Wes Watts and the IT team. I believe Ben Levenger is here as well. The associate superintendents and the instructional directors and any principals and principal mentors here with us today. A special thank you to all of you. There are a few unsung heroes that I really wanted to point it out, and then I'll get started. Barbara Pometto could not be with us this evening, but she's been instrumental with helping us think through things at the beginning. Monica Holmes, who is here with us tonight, has been instrumental in carrying out all the logistics for these wonderful opportunities what we present our administrators with. And Wanda Battle, who works tirelessly behind the scenes in coordinating support for our process for administrators. So again, my appreciation and respect to all of you. So let's dive in by giving you a look at a representation of the data to provide context. Time is up. All right, the Wallace Grant has provided many opportunities we'd otherwise not have. None more true than the ability to create new programs for our administrators and aspiring administrators. This chart represents the number of teacher leaders and administrators that have benefited from the programs we've had in place since 2011. I'll talk more about the programs in a moment, but you can see that our work on developing assistant principals has been a major focus since the inception of the grant. Teacher leaders have also benefited greatly through the creation of new certification programs that have specific areas of focus. As a result of our new programs and partnerships, we are pleased to identify that 38% of the graduates in our preferred programs have gone on to secure a principalship and lead one of our schools. Please note that we designed a new selection process that would help ensure we are presenting the best and brightest to our CEO for his ultimate decision. We wanted to illuminate that the work of our grant focused on building the internal capacity of our current assistant principals and aspiring teacher leaders. This chart highlights that our efforts to showcase and pull from within have been intentional. As you can see, of the last 110 principals appointed, 80 have come from within Prince George's County Public Schools. The next slide gives you a snapshot of our VALED data. VALED is a 360-degree evaluation instrument that all of our principals and assistant principals take each year and serve as 4% of the overall evaluation. Teachers, instructional directors provide input and complete a survey of feedback of the principals, while the principal and teachers complete a survey of feedback on the assistant principals. This was a critical part of the Wiles Grant proposal, as it was originally used to assess gaps in the professional development being provided for assistant principals. VALED hadn't been used in this particular way, and the Wallace Foundation found this approach very intriguing and unique. VALED provides a normed data point, so it gives us information that we can compare against other administrators, their peers nationally. On this and the following slide, you can see that there are areas that across the aggregate, our principals are proficient in areas for growth. For instance, the connections to external influences and performance accountability. We know how important it is for principals to work, communicate with our families and business partners, so addressing this systemically with our principals is extremely important. Performance accountability speaks to the principal's ability to hold themselves and staff accountable to the goals and agreed upon standards of the school. So we need to be diligent and coordinated with our supports to principals as a district to help principals grow in this area as well. So with every component and in every examination of data, we uncover challenges. Just in this very small data capture on VALED, for example, there are challenges. How do we best coordinate our support while also differentiating the type of support for administrators? As fortunate as we are to have the resources we do, it is hard to meet the individual needs of each administrator without potentially burning out our mentors, instructional directors, leadership coaches, and other staff. So how do we create a sustainable and balanced approach of support? So our first step with tackling the requirements of the grant was to address the alignment of our work by developing leader standards. Our leader standards were developed in conjunction and collaboration with our labor partners in the Association of Supervisory and Administrative School Personnel, ASASP. I would like to thank Ms. Doris Reed, the executive director who could not be with us this evening, but I know Mr. Hugh Weathers is present, so I would like to acknowledge him and thank him and them for their support from the beginning of the grant through to today. Mr. Weathers, thank you. Ms. Reed was there at the onset of the grant. Even before we received the grant, she was partnering with the administration to re-envision our evaluation system and help inform the leader standards. Our leader standards are aligned to everything: our evaluation system, job descriptions, our professional development experiences, our training, our university partner programs, our private partner programs, and everything else we do involving leadership development. Keeping the valid data point in front of you, as this graph reflects, our administrators are evaluated along the leader standards. Again, our data illustrates our strengths and informs our approach to the challenges that exist. On this slide, for example, we have to consider, how do we move administrators along the evaluation continuum from ineffective to effective, and from effective to highly effective, and from highly effective beyond? Component two, high-quality pre-service training. To get a quick understanding of one of our efforts and work to date, let's take a peek at a few graduates of our Aspiring Leaders Program for Student Success, ALPS, program through this video.
I enjoy being an instructional leader because I get to affect the lives of 650 children every day. The academic program that I have structured for my children gives them a different opportunity to experience education in ways that they haven't experienced before. So I enjoy the fact that I get to build something and actually get to see a success in the lives of the students that I affect.
Professional development opportunities that I've been able to participate as a principal was New Principals Academy. That was a monthly meeting where we were able to meet with our mentor principal, talk about different things that were relevant to the position, and really have time at the end to be able just to dialogue with our mentor principals to talk about things that were happening in our building, to get feedback on that. So that was very helpful. Also participating in our monthly systemic principals meetings. That's a great opportunity to be able to connect and network with other principals and have conversations and also get more information around district initiatives, receive professional development from different departments that you may not always be able to get when you're inside of your building. Our Summer Leadership Institute was a great opportunity for us to be able to work together as colleagues, receive professional development, to get clarification on different things such as the FFT process. And it's just a really good opportunity to be able to come together as a cohort of principals and receive more information and to get more guidance on what our mission and our vision is moving forward in Prince George's County Public Schools, and tons of support from the county to help us be successful as principals.
Be an instructional leader, to know that I've put an instructional lead team in place that's all about the business of supporting teaching and learning, that's all about the business of building teacher capacity so that they can prepare lessons that are engaging, lessons that are rigorous, lessons that are relevant, lessons that prepare our students to be college and career ready. There's no greater feeling in the world, and that's the number one reason why I enjoy being an instructional leader. There were many components of ALPS that prepared me to be a principal. I'll focus on a few. One of the things that we talked about in the ALPS program was the theory of action. And we were charged to come up with goals and pretty much a plan that we would implement as we become principals. And through that whole process, it caused me to think about what's important. You know, building teacher capacity, providing professional development, being able to analyze data, being able to have conversations and include our stakeholders on what's important for our school.
So we're fortunate to have, I saw two of the stars of that particular video. If they would stand and be recognized, we have Sheena Hardy at Cherokee Lane, and I saw Felicia McMillan at North Forestville Elementary. Very proud of the work that they're doing. And they talked a little bit about ALPS, which is one of our signature programs. And we have the cohort of, the third cohort of ALPS. Several members are with us here tonight. They're just getting back from a three-day mid-year training at Turf Valleys with members of my team who are also present here. And so, hey, ALPS, cohort number three, how are you doing tonight?
Oh, wow.
All right. So we appreciate them. They've had long 3 days, tough. We did some tough grilling with them yesterday, so I know they're probably exhausted. So I do appreciate you all for being here. And then we have a special, another ALPS graduate with us, the principal at Parkdale High School, Tanya Washington, who has a wonderful story. If you've never met Tanya, great person to talk to about her leadership experience in Prince George's County. And Dwayne Brown and, you know, we talk about our work around students, and I'm always pleased and impressed with the students that are interning with communications, Channel 96 and 38, and those students who helped produce that video. I always appreciate their hard work. So thank you, students. Keep up the great work. So at this time, I'd like to bring up our very talented project manager for the Wallace work. She came back home to Prince George's County to be with us, Ms. Damaris Blondeville.
Thank you, Doug, and thank you, everyone, for allowing us to speak tonight. I would like to share with you a little bit more about what we've been doing with the Wallace Grant here in Prince George's County. We were fortunate to leverage funding from the Wallace Foundation in a variety of ways, and one of the most significant ways was in our programs. You just heard from a few of our most talented folks, from the ALPS graduates to the new principals who've been appointed to positions in our county. Our partnership with the National Institute of School Leadership, known as NISL, afforded us to have our very own curriculum. Aspiring administrators are accessing a leadership curriculum based on strong theory and research from the first time in Prince George's County history. We now have a comprehensive assistant principal induction program, something we've never had before. We are also very fortunate to learn from our friends and partners at New Leaders, which has produced some outstanding leaders for us. As our relationship evolves, we continue to appreciate their support as thought partners in this work. Our university portfolio has also grown and diversified. You see here that we have several partnerships and are forging new ones in the upcoming year. Each partner has a specific focus, and all programs are aligned to our leader standards. McDaniel College is our traditional standard administration certification program. John Hopkins University launched program development this past fall, and the first cohort will begin in the fall of 2015. And this will focus on urban leadership. University of Maryland will have a STEM focus, and their program development also began this fall, with the first cohort beginning in the fall of 2015. Bowie State University, our original partner in the grant, has a teacher leadership focus, as well as George Washington University. We would also like to recognize those of our partners who may be with us here tonight. If you are here with us, please do stand. Jennifer Beck Wilson from NISL, Linda Jones from New Leaders. And if any of our university partners are here in the audience, and those OTD staff members that support our university programs every single day, please do stand as well. Thank you. And we'd like to also recognize, and I know she's not here this evening, our long-standing partnership with the National Association for Elementary School Principals, Ms. Carol Riley, who provides most of our mentor certification training. So again, thank you tonight. Thank you this evening for allowing me to share. And I'm going to pass it back over to Doug.
Thanks, Damaris. Again, with what we are learning, we have identified challenges. This slide identifies just a few of the challenges related to pre-service training, the challenges of sustaining leadership programs at the universities, or figuring out how to continue to support and coordinate all the programs in the Office of Talent Development when the grant-funded positions are no longer funded through the grant, and we lose the talented people managing them. All serious things we must consider. Component three is selective hiring. And under a previous administration, we were able to establish an administrative procedure for the first time around the principal selection process. We now have a tiered screening process for principal applicants. There are multiple steps from utilization of a research-based screening instrument, like the Gallup Principal Insight Tool, to our sophisticated electronic-based exercise for candidates that examine their problem-solving and observational skills. It is important to note that we have over 1,500 current employees that have administrator endorsements. We have over 700 applicants for assistant principal vacancies on average per year, and over 200 applicants on average per year for principal vacancies. Our Wallace work and this ongoing focus on human capital efforts have increased the coordination between and among offices, the area offices, and the Division of Human Resources in particular. We went from a very unclear and sometimes subjective process with minimal guidance to a more robust set of tools with clear guidelines. The beauty of the grant is that it was made with our human capital efforts in mind. While we were able to identify our own challenges, the grant also reaffirmed areas where we needed improvement. We began addressing our processes before the grant, and we continue to do so today. We know that communication can still be a challenge in articulating the process. So how can we do that consistently for all interested parties? We also know that we have to support internal candidates who have gone through the process unsuccessfully by providing feedback and engaging them in ways that are helpful to their development. So one way we're going to do this is to hold regular "So You Want to Be an Administrator" workshops and webinars. In fact, we're going to hold a workshop on February 10th from 5 to 7 p.m., so look for the announcement. These workshops are geared for both interested candidates and serve as forums for those that have gone through the process unsuccessfully to learn more about the necessary skills and common missteps individuals take in moving through the process. Component four, evaluation and support. While the state became a key driver in our revamping of the new teacher evaluation system, PGCPS was ahead of the game in 2011, already taking steps to address the revision of our administrator's evaluation system. The Gates Foundation provided funding to look at teacher effectiveness. PGCPS leveraged that learning with a focus on administrators' proficiency. The FIRST program provided a vehicle to examine evaluation with an entirely different lens. Again, with the support and in collaboration with our labor partners in ASASP and PGCEA in particular, initial conversations and work pre-WILS and pre-MSD were taking place. Now, because of you, the board, and you with the board support and the CEO's vision, we have a fantastic new Office of Employee Performance and Evaluation that is leading this work in the district. WILS resources have accelerated the technology advances that support the infrastructure development with Oracle, Valid, and the development of a leader tracking system. On the job support has been largely supported through the expansion and refinement of our mentoring program for administrators. We now have mentoring support for our ALPS participants and all novice principals. We offered a varied and robust catalog of professional development opportunities for assistant principals and principals at the local, state, and national level. We were fortunate to have the state superintendent, along with 14 other counties from the state of Maryland, county in Virginia, and the District of Columbia, along with representatives from MSDE, here with us last Friday to support our assistant principal symposium, which illustrates her fundamental belief in leadership development. And Dr. Lowry has long been a friend of the WILS Foundation. As part of an extension grant, the Principal Supervisor Initiative, we now have the School Administrative Manager, or SAMS, process for our instructional directors, selected principals, and their respective administrative assistants. This program helps all of those who are participating examine how they use time both managerially and instructionally. I can't wait to share that data with you as we move further into this work. Our pioneering and innovative leadership work with the foundation has garnered national attention and a spotlight on the great work here in Prince George's County Public Schools. For instance, a few of our administrators, like Nakai Brown at Mary Harris Mother Jones and Kim Washington at Hydesville Middle School, both will be featured in an upcoming WNET public television special demonstrating effective leadership practices. And Mark Covington at Duval High School is co-authoring a piece for a national publication highlighting his work with developing assistant principals. Y'all can stand up, because I know I saw Mark in the Kai. And Kim. And there's many, many more. Kim is also working on the national leader standards that are used across the country, so she's an author on there if you look at the notes. So really, really fabulous things that our principals doing. And there are many more principals participating in professional learning communities across the country and attracting the same attention. Each month at our systemic principal meetings, we try to recognize a few principals for the work they are doing locally, statewide, and nationally. One challenge that I want to bring to your attention relative to this component is that much of the feedback and data that is available shows the need for experiences that are real-time and practical. How might we fund a full-fledged residency model to provide the types of experiences that future principals will need to be successful is a question that needs to be explored and answered. So the impact for change. Included in your ancillary materials was a white paper on how we have leveraged our learning from Wallace to inform systemic change. As we move forward, we must look at sustainability. The steps we will take to do this are outlined on this slide. Executing the work plan, developing a sustainability plan, which we've been doing for the last few years as part of our requirement, developing a cost plan. So understanding the real cost to what we did is important to understanding the real cost in the future. Included in your materials were the projected expenditures for phase four of the grant and the scope of work, all of which must be approved by the CEO and then the Wallace Board before the final work plan is approved. I already mentioned the informing change white paper. But please remember that the Wallace Foundation is conducting a comprehensive evaluation and effect study that will evaluate each component to determine the impact of leadership on student achievement. I hope we provided a helpful perspective of what we are learning in this work while highlighting the great things we, Prince George's County Public Schools, have done to advance the development of our employees and create a national footprint for leadership development. This slide shows that we are very mindful of our challenges, but I wanted to leave you with the positive impact our work has had both locally and nationally. So what better way to close our presentation than with remarks from our program officer from the Wallace Foundation, Mr. Andy Cole. Andy?
Good evening.
Good evening.
My name's Andy Cole, and I work with the Wallace Foundation, and I'm very pleased to be here. I'm especially pleased to be here because I'm local. I live in Fairfax County, and this is a very easy commute. I want to paraphrase or actually quote the president by saying, this is good news, folks. 2.5 years ago, 87 districts competed for this particular grant. And six were granted this funding. And the funding was in, actually, the investment, I'm going to say, by Wallace was $100 million. Not just the grants to the districts, but grants to a number of other programs. And there's at least 81 programs that aren't happy about this process that you're going through. And I hear from them often. First, I want to say, really, you have a wonderful staff, very creative, very focused, and you're showing leadership to the whole country. And that leadership is around an area that has never, the uncharted territory, which is a systematic approach to the development of principals. You've seen all that material, but I want to highlight a couple things. One is, there are at least three things that people are trying to emulate from the work that you're doing. One is the focus on assistant principals. And that summit that was held last Friday, which I unfortunately wasn't able to be there, but has really provided a focus for not just the metropolitan area, but the entire country. People are looking very closely at the work that you're doing with assistant principals. The second piece I want to highlight is another piece that was mentioned in there, which is the portfolio of provider programs. And those portfolio of provider programs are an outstanding way of looking at the way principals are developed. And the third thing I want to highlight is the leadership that your district is providing through Dr. Maxwell and through Doug Anthony. You're seen as leaders in this particular work. And one of the very specific things that I hope we'll be able to talk about is the way we may be able to leverage that leadership to aid specifically programs around the country. And maybe at another time, we'll be able to talk about that type of leadership. And finally, the area that the Wallace Foundation is looking for in terms of a return on their investment are three areas. One is scale, and you all have done an excellent job of scaling within your organization. The other is sustainability, and as we begin to look at the work that you're doing, it's clear that you're going to be able to sustain this work well beyond the original investment that Wallace has provided. But the third thing that is really important for the foundation is the kind of spread. So are you spreading this work out to different districts? And over the period of time in the last 2 years, you've actually been presenting to the National Governors Association, to a number of different organizations that are interested in the work that's being done in this particular district, and it's outstanding work. So finally, I want to thank you for the work that we're doing as partners. Even though we are providing some of the investment, you are providing the most important part, which is the creativity and focus that allows us to be successful. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Andy, and that concludes our presentation, so we're open for questions.
Thank you very much. Before we go to questions, when I started this discussion, I'm glad that so many people are paying attention. I got texts, I got emails, I had people kicking me under the table. And so please let me apologize for the fact that I did skip public comment, and I was supposed to do that before I went to this. I want to make sure, is Mark King in the room? Is he here? Mr. King, I don't want to stop this. I'm going to have this discussion, and then as soon as we have these questions answered, I'm going to bring you up. My apologies for skipping that, sir. Thank you for your patience. All right. Dr. Anderson.
Of course, I want to commend you on this wonderful program, and thanks to the Wallace Foundation for believing in us and helping us to get stronger. I want to get a better understanding of the roles that the universities play in the program. You mentioned several university partners that will work with us in specific areas. You talked about STEM, leadership, several other areas. And I want to know if each participant has an opportunity to be involved in a workshop or certain curriculum with the various institutions that you mentioned, or the various areas, in the various areas that you mentioned.
Sure. So the university programs that we identified are leadership certification programs for them to get endorsements to serve as supervisors or assistant principals in the district. So there's a core set of coursework that they have to take. And what we've done is we flavor them, obviously, with Prince George's County context and our leader standards. And then each of them have a particular focus. So if a person were to go into the STEM candidate program, they're going to have courses specifically around that are germane to the STEAM process moving forward. In each of the universities, what we decided is that everyone can offer a basic certification program. But by having a slant or a specific focus in each of them, we're actually building a different capacity. So even those individuals that come out that aren't placed as principals or assistant principals, whatever, they're helping a school because they'll still be in a school with a very now unique lens and some professional capacity they hadn't had before.
So the assistant principals or the principals can select which areas they want to get certified in, and is there a minimum number of areas they should? be certified in?
So each program is its own certification program. There's a standard 18-credit course that, in order to be an administrator, you have to have that basic certification. In addition to that, we'll have a specific focus. So those teacher leaders who are interested in going into administration can actually choose one of the different programs, and if they were accepted to those programs, would then have that level of a certification.
They would use one. They can
Yeah, just one. Yeah, they wouldn't go to all. Okay.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Mr. Valentine.
Thank you. I had a few questions, but one just came to mind, particularly around how you are advising these would-be teacher leaders on which tracks are in most demand in the school system. So ensuring that the choice is not arbitrary, that you're saying, you know, moving forward, we see this as a growth area, and the chances of you moving into a position would be higher if you chose this than that. And they, you know, they could make a choice and say, well, my passion isn't here, that's fine. But maybe if you're bilingual or if you're, you know, looking to expand our science and tech program to middle schools, that, you know, having someone who's doing that would be more important. So that's sort of one thing. The other questions around sort of some of the training, particularly around the AP, IPs, and other sort of professional development programs about, are these programs voluntary or mandatory? And if so, or kind of talk a little bit about that. The other question around the funding source, like most officials, I'm cautiously optimistic about sort of grant funding where, you know, it ends, and then oftentimes we have to, you know, support that in order to continue the work. Can you talk a little bit about the investments that we're putting in now that the funding is sort of sunsetting to ensure that, you know, we have some longevity? You know, like most people, I believe that these programs have to have a little more time to meet fruition. I think what you'll hear from a lot of administrators and principals, parents, and otherwise are saying, Prince George's County is a place where the world comes to test out things, and we just let them come, and they'll test, and they'll come and test, and come and test, and try it. But when are we going to kind of stick our foot in the ground and say, we're going to do this, we're going to ensure that this is something that we give a chance to, you know, try, and then give the time it takes. So talk a little bit about the investments we're putting in as Wallace is sort of moving out, and how you envision you making the case to the board and to the administration about continuing the investments. Talk a little bit about, you know, are these programs voluntary? And if so, what type of messaging you're giving to those administrators to convince them that it's important? And if it's mandatory, you know, how are we making sure that, you know, it's worth their time? And then lastly, what kind of advice you're giving to these teacher leaders in choosing which track based on system needs?
Sure. So I'll start with the first question around investment and sustainability. So for us, we spent a lot of time talking. I didn't talk a lot about infrastructure, but some of it was just building models and ways to facilitate and track data around all of our employees in the system. So working with IT, working with human resources, we're trying to build an infrastructure where we can track, pay attention to what people have in terms of their levels of expertise, and then trying to now build out succession planning models that show different pathways, not just through the principalship, but through different places within an organization. The other thing about sustainability and thinking forward about that, in turn, is one of the things that I think we did that was most strategic is that we built our own curriculum that we own. So whereas we were used to having consultants come in, do some work for a little while, pay them while we had a grant or money, we now own a program that we can replicate, we can tweak, we can refine, and we are now the trainers. So in our model, they trained us to be able to train others, and in turn, we learned how to train it and own ourselves. So you're looking at people in this room who actually do that training. So that's some of the sustainability. Now, we'll give you the full scope of our sustainability work as we continue to work through it. The other question that you ask in terms of the programs and are they mandatory, I'll let Pamela and Damaris speak to those programs, but I can tell you that one of the things Wallace has helped us fund is systemic assistant principal meetings every month, and those are mandatory. And so as you can imagine, in a system that's this large, that has over 250 assistant principals, The logistics of managing that and not impacting the school by taking them out is something we continue to work through, thinking more strategically about webinars and those opportunities. But there's nothing like working side by side with administrators on their practice that I think will make the difference, so we have to continue to work through that. So that's a mandatory opportunity. The APIP is an induction program, so it's mandatory for those new assistant principals. And again, we're trying to make sure that we onboard new assistant principals and administrators and principals, for that matter, in a different way. The last question I think I'll speak to was relative to the teacher leaders and how do we inform them about their opportunities. Mr. Valentine, that's an excellent question. I think it's always a challenge. But what we do is we try to make sure we have opportunities and forums to speak with them. You participate with us and been very helpful in our teacher leadership work that we're doing. We try to make sure that we're communicating with principals. We leverage our work with, like, the National Board teachers and just trying to make sure in every opportunity we're presenting information both on the website and through advertisements in the Daily Dispatch. If you look in there every day, there's something from our office that's in identifying training that we offer. And so I think, you know, as we get more intentional about how we can communicate that, they are very highly competitive programs. So, you know, there's only room for 15 to 20 people in a cohort in most instances. And so we ask for recommendations. We ask for people who are willing. So normally folks know that call through our office, and we try to facilitate it that way. So we do have to continue to get better about those communications, and that's why I indicate that as one of the challenges.
I will say I congratulate you and your team on the work. The one shining star about our system, at least before I became on the board, was our professional development program, to the point where we were supporting other regions because we were exporting so many teachers.
Yeah.
And they were coming here for strong development, and that was something that no one questioned.
Yeah.
But a lot of our best and brightest ended up elsewhere. So I definitely commend you, and I hope that we all can do a better job of retaining those that we do develop. A couple recommendations. One, I hope that we continue to reach back as the program is progressing to survey teachers and administrators and principals saying, what do you think so far?
Yep.
To keep sort of checking in. And lastly, something that Dr. Davis had brought up in some of the AP meetings, that folks are meeting in feeder groups so that an AP at a high school, an AP at a feeder mm-hmm. middle, and an AP at a, APs at, you know, feeder elementaries are talking,
right.
And making sure that, you know, we may have system-wide meeting, that's fine, but in as much as we are doing this, but passing the baton, this relay race of passing children from elementary schools to middle to high, that the administrators in those feeder programs are on the same page. I think Dr. Davis mentioned you were doing that in the principal meetings.
Right.
I just wasn't sure you were doing an AP. I just recommend that. But again, I commend you on the team and continue to ensure that our professional development continues to be the best in the region, which it has always been, and I expect it to be in the future.
Thank you, sir. I appreciate it.
Thank you. Ms. Grady.
Good evening. Thank you so much for your presentation. This is definitely very exciting. And thank you once again to the Wallace Foundation for just your investment in our leaders. My question is related to the contextual data.
Mm-hmm.
So with the different numbers of the internal and external, 80 and 30, does that mean that the 80, they completed the entire training, and that also, do we have information, have we retained everyone that has gone through the training? Because this is a great investment,
mm-hmm.
and just wanted to know if you had that data.
Yeah, so the 80 just represents internal folks. So there are folks obviously that have come through the ranks that have not participated in one of our premier or signature programs, if you will. But that's a representation of just Prince George's County employees coming through the ranks. There's been, you know, lots of questions, and sometimes it's a challenge that we're not looking within. So that number is not necessarily just germane to our programs, because they started staggering. You know, we've built a program, it starts next year, and so on. So we'll continue to get that data, and by the time that we're done with the funding, the effect study still goes on for a year after. So we'll be able to kind of give you more numbers at that point.
So then the 80 doesn't mean that there are 80 80 principals or teachers that actually completed
correct
a training. Okay. And then do you have a breakdown of the different certifications per who opted to do teacher certification or
Oh, for the university programs? Mm-hmm. We can get you that information. Two of them are in development. They'll start in a fall cohort. And our leader tracking system is going to, when it's fully developed, we'll be able to identify the current certifications, the additional certifications. And Mr. Valentine made a good point. And I forget that, but I think it ties into this conversation. When we're looking at our diverse portfolio of university partners, we know that our CEO, the board, is interested in continuing expanding our programs and our specialty schools and those things. And so we want to pay attention to that. So to his point about bilingual you know, programs and opportunities, we're looking to continue to build that with our universities too. So that was a great point and a lost opportunity for me to share that. But we're paying attention to that as we build out the portfolio.
Yeah, and I think it's great because the retention piece is important due to the investment that's being made.
Right.
And then I think it can just help build the sustainability around the train-the-trainer, which I think that's pretty that's a great way of thinking. And I commend you for actually you say you're building your own curriculum because after a while, I think you know best what's
Absolutely.
Needed.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So I got a quick question about the curriculum.
Sure.
As well. I was on the advisory committee for this work before I was on the board, so you know I'm a fan.
Yeah.
Although my attendance at the advisory committee meeting is... hopefully you weren't taking attendance, but
you're good.
But we tried. I definitely tried my best. And actually, one of the issues that I really cared about and tried to bring to that around the curriculum was around a couple of different issues, particularly around the fact that the principal's job and leadership in schools has changed dramatically. Mm-hmm. I don't think, frankly, that licensure requirements in the state have caught up to that change, and I'm not sure about some of the college programs.
Mm-hmm.
So in the curriculum, I wonder, there's a couple of big things that I think have been critically important. One is how our leaders are thinking about leadership completely differently, mm-hmm. and distributed leadership in schools. That they're looking to their teachers in particular, but other staff, not as folks who they control and boss around, but folks who are their partners and who have some real authority and say about how schools are run. So talk a little bit about how we're doing a better job with ensuring that our folks who have the official role as leaders are doing a good job distributing that work.
That's a great question. I imagine my colleagues here from the ALPS program. Yeah, I see a couple smiles over there. So one of the things that we do is that we have a very good mentoring program, and we have really seasoned great folks working and running this program. And so just yesterday, as an example, Dr. Eubanks, I shared with them what I see in terms of the data relative to unsuccessful principals. The fact that if you don't build relationships, that if you're not inclusive, if you're not empowering folks, if you're really not paying attention to the processes that you use to build staff, then you'll be unsuccessful. Now, we know that typically you'll have someone did something with money, unfortunately, or someone did something, all the different stories that you see on the news that, kind of publicly know. But I see the interior work. I see the fact that if people don't learn how to talk to one another,
yes.
if they're not paying attention to the salient points in Great by Choice or in Leadership and Self-Deception, which is a great book around culture that we've leveraged with them and we continue to leverage throughout the district, to really have people understand that all of this wild work is great, but it's about the people, because the people make the programs. The people will continue to make the sustainability happen, not the programs. And so we have conversations. We do mid-year checks. They had mid-year checks, and we kind of evaluate where they are, and we listen to their conversations to see if they build that inclusivity. So I could be too long-winded, so I'll leave it at that. But I will say that we've addressed it. We continue to tweak and modify it so it reflects what's going on now.
Wonderful. Thank you. Mr. Burrows.
Well, once again, thank you and your staff for the work that you're doing, and Ms. Sheltley and everyone else.
Sure.
Thank you. Remarkable work. The question that I have is that on slide, or I just hit the wrong button, but you talked about the different certifications and different programs that you have.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a difference between going through a program and measuring. How do you measure success, I guess, is the root of my question. Because you could go through the program and still not be an effective leader or effective teacher, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. So how are you measuring outcomes? How are you measuring success?
That's a great question.
Yes, it is.
And I think there's several different ways that we measure success. The first thing, let me qualify it by saying, if we get anyone through the program successfully, they've grown. The goal is that they've grown. Professional development is about growth over time. It's not an event. It's about growth over the time. So if we can take people through our programs and they're better for it, they're better for our kids.
Right.
But in terms of those, like, so that's a, there's two things. There's those meaningful and courageous conversations for those who are not ready either to lead or are not ready or haven't proven themselves through the program. So we have to figure out how to give them more support. And then there's the data points, like the Val-Ed information that I showed you. The Val-Ed data is a really good indicator because teachers, principals, and supervisors have input around a person's capacity. And when you use data points like that, it gives you a better picture of what your strengths and weaknesses are. So we can be targeted in terms of how we give them support. And so to me, as they grow over time, that's our indicators of success. Obviously, as those folks who go through our preferred programs become principals, that's another indicator of success. And those that turn around and then do turnkey training or support systemic efforts, that's an indicator. So when our FEC study come out from the Wallace Foundation, they're going to look to see if how we changed our structure for selection and recruitment made an impact on student achievement. How did our leader standards and the way we provided professional development have an impact on student achievement? So those will be some of the indicators that we will look at long term. But in the interim, we use their evaluation data. We use evaluation reports from the professional development they receive. We use feedback, anecdotal, and informal observations, all those combinations of data points.
OK, that makes sense. And I'll be interested to see that long-term data when you have it.
Yep.
And I guess to follow up, so once you've deemed someone effective,
mm-hmm.
What is that placement process? What does that look like? Because what I'm interested in knowing, is it up to the candidate? Do they have discretion? The point that I'm trying to get at is I want to make sure that we have our most effective teachers or principals or leaders in areas that require the most leadership and support, you know what
mm-hmm.
I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Right? It's important to me that leaders that are responsible for turning around schools in our communities of great poverty or low performance, that those schools have the best leaders possible for that turnaround. So can you describe your placement?
Sure. So it's our placement, it's not me. I'm going to be on record. But what we do is we try to put as much data in front of executive leadership and Dr. Maxwell as possible. So I'll give you a little, maybe I'll pull the curtains back on our process. So what we do first is we get an inventory of who this person is through, you know, your normal resume screening process. But we also take them through a series of different exercises. We use one tool, a Gallup instrument, that gives us an indicator of someone's strengths and weaknesses and where they might be good fits based on some kind of common characteristics. We also use a tool called a principal exercise that we developed internally that looks at how people problem solve, whether they engage people. And on the other side, it actually has candidates look at opportunities of teachers. And we look at how they evaluate instruction. And through our rubrics and things that we use, it gives us a broader sense about their strengths. On top of that, we use things like strength finders to really look at the balance of what would make this person, what are their kind of top five strengths. We also look at the community input. So while we know we need to continue to work on our survey that we have, we do go into the community, as you know. We kind of get a sense of what the community wants. So what we do is we develop profiles of all the candidates, and we look at the community needs, and we try to marry the two. And so we give that information to executive leadership, and when they make a decision, they're looking at all these different data points and the needs of the community to hopefully make a good fit. We also find out all those extra things you may not know about a person that speaks eight different languages and all those different things, so that when we're looking at best fit, those things are part of their profile. We call it a baseball card behind the door, but that's basically what it is. It's like everyone's stats around what makes them special.
And I know you're doing a great job. I know Dr. Davis and her staff super committed and have done a very successful job in placing leaders. But I guess just because you said a whole lot, but I'm not sure if you quite answered the question that I was looking for. So you have a super effective leader. Mm-hmm. How do you convince them, or how do you get them to go to a school with the greatest need?
So go ahead.
Okay.
Or occasionally tell.
We had examples of that this year, okay, in which you did approve some transfers,
right,
of principals in high needs areas that we felt that they were going to be the good, a best fit. And sometimes an experienced principal is asked simply to go somewhere else because we know what their talent is. So it's just as simple as something we ask.
Great. Yeah. That makes it easy. Thanks. All right.
Ms. Jacobs.
Thank you. Following up from Mr. Burrell's comments. So, I mean, this grant was first issued in 2011. And so, you know, I kind of would like to see, or would like to have seen kind of included with this, the administration is sort of revamping and doing, you know, revitalizing, if you will, the how around how the principal selection process happens, the training and things like that. Mm-hmm. But I would like to have seen, or would like to see, so what's happened since 2011 around student achievement for those principals who have been in that training and who have had the experience already, because that's a good point. You know, oftentimes districts get, and sometimes it's a requirement, but you get grant funding that is related to driving student achievement, and then the follow-up has to demonstrate that that's happening,
right,
from one perspective. But the other piece to it is the sustainability part of it. So I think that, you know, it's important to know how have students been doing in those schools. And then, you know, the stipulation, and I know some of that requires some of the union interaction, but, you know, when you go through this training and send people through training, the expectations is that they are going to be in places where we have the greatest need. Mm-hmm. And so I would like to see what's happened since 2011 around those pieces. I have some idea, obviously, but going forward, I think that's also good information to know for the public.
Absolutely, Ms. Jacobs. We'll make sure to have that for you.
I don't think we have any more questions for you.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
Thank you for that great much. Presentation. Thank you.
Thank you.
I just was reminded again not to forget again. So before we go on to the next agenda item, without objection, colleagues, I'm going to go back to our registered speakers. We only have one this evening, so I won't go through the whole spiel on that, but just a reminder that this is a public comment forum where we'll listen to your comments, but we cannot speak to them directly. Normally, I would say you have exactly 3 minutes and no more, but we might give our speaker a little extra leeway for that. So Mark King, come on up, please. Thank you.
Yes. Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
I'm here tonight representing the students, yes, faculty, parents, and greater community served by Forestville High School. We are here today to urge that Forestville High School be restored to a military academy status at the end of this school year to be effective this August at the beginning of next school year. We, Forestville, were the victim of a catastrophic mistake, and we are seeking to help seeking the help of the current administration and school board remedy the situation. 285 members of the community have signed a petition in support of this campaign. A little history. 2003 was a finalization of a transformation process from high school to military academy. Those close to the project recognized that enhanced structure and the creation of a positive identity would be powerful tools to building a successful school. They were right. The first class graduated in 2006-07, and by 2009-10, the improvement was evident. The school had produced consecutive years of satisfactory AYP in 2007-2008. There were dramatic reductions in vandalism, violence, suspension, and expulsions. An improved aggregate GPA, graduation rate, SAT scores, and a myriad of other positive effects were noticeable around the school. Just as this positive and productive atmosphere was created and taking hold, generating a new normal where students routinely became Millennium Scholars. Some cadets entered the service in the Naval Academy, athletes excelled, and the school pride was high. all of that progress was undone. Tonight, I will not go into detail about how the will of the community was ignored, the facts about the progress swept under the rug, and how a contrived fallacy was used to excuse a grievous error against our children. Tonight we ask your support to correct this mistake. The students want the military academy. The staff wants the military academy.
Keep going, sir.
Okay. The parents want it and the community needs it. In this era of education reform, the military academy is comparable to a charter school and favorable to a magnet program. The JRTC itself is in line with Common Core. Facts are the cost would be ineligible because the military academy was funded by the United States Army. This expansion would not cost us a penny. The school is prepared to accommodate the restoration in terms of supplies and structure. Logistically, all the transportation systems and agreements are still in place. The students that chose to opt out and go elsewhere are close to three other schools as they are to us. What we lose in population can be easily replaced by out-of-county, out-of-boundary students who seek to attend Forestville to this day. To conclude, a stroke of the pen is all that is needed to provide a community of less affluent and a little less politically connected people a resource to improve itself. Forestville Military Academy was an asset that we cannot afford to lose. Help us help ourselves, and Forestville Military Academy was that too.
Thank you very much, sir. And will you leave a copy of those comments for us, if you will?
Okay.
All right. Thank you very much, sir. All right. Do you have a recommendation regarding our next discussion item, Dr. Maxwell?
Yes, Dr. Eubanks, in light of the inclement weather causing us to cancel after school activities last night, we did not hold the public hearing on the boundary changes and would like to respectfully request that the board move this to the next board meeting so that we have time to speak with the community. And we can go through what we have here tonight, but we'd like to be able to give you a better sense of what we hear.
Great. So there's a recommendation that we postpone this to the next board meeting, and we will be having a public hearing in between these two board meetings to get that done.
We've rescheduled for the 28th.
28th at 7 p.m.
January at 7 p.m.
Okay, great. Is there objection? All right. Seeing none, we'll go on ahead and have that at the next board meeting. Thank you very much. So we will move on to item 5.0, the consent agenda, and I yield the floor to Dr. Maxwell for an introduction of items 5.1 and 5.2.
Thank you, Dr. Eubanks. Items 5.1 and 5.2 are on the agenda this evening for approval of proclamations commemorating School Counseling Week and Peace Week in the Prince George's County Public Schools.
Thank you. May I have a motion to approve items 5.1 and 5.2 under the consent agenda? It has been moved and seconded. Seeing no discussion, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed? Thank you. That motion carries. We'll move on to the budget consent agenda. A reminder that the student member cannot vote on this item. And I yield the floor to Dr. Maxwell for an introduction of items 6.1 through 6.4.
Thank you, Dr. Eubanks. These items, 6.1 through 6.4, are on the agenda for approval of a change order for an energy performance contract and approval of charter school agreements for Imagine Morningside, XL Academy, and Imagine Lincoln Public Charter Schools.
Thank you, colleagues. I'll entertain a motion to approve items 6.1 through 6.4 under the budget consent agenda. Thank you. It has been moved and seconded. Don't be so excited about it. I see, Dr. Anderson.
Yes, just a question. In the charter renewal agreements, we see that the cost per student is about $8,900-some dollars. But in the budget, we see that the cost per student is about 9,000 some. I just want to know what other costs are considered when we speak of cost per student in a charter school.
So there are a number of things that can affect that, but in general, locals are authorized to have a administrative fee that's deducted from the general cost of per pupil expenditures, and then respective charter schools can contract back to us certain things or not, so they can have transportation or they can ask us to handle transportation. They can ask us to handle other aspects of the operation of school, or they can do it as operation. So the variation between what they are receiving and what we have is a combination of the administrative charge and anything they may charge back, I believe is the right answer to that question.
Do we provide transportation for any of the charter schools?
No, but in some places they do. But that's a fee that they do. They would have to.
So that wouldn't be reflected in our budget, though.
No, it would be reflected in a lower amount that they would actually have per child, because they would be contracting that back to us. So they have the option. Maybe you could say it more legally. They have the option of providing as much service as they wish, or piggybacking on services that we already provide, including food service, for example. They could provide their own sort of food service program, or they could use the food services program that we provide in the county. Mm-hmm. But they would have to pay us to do that if they contracted back to us. So the reason you see differences is because different charter schools have first the administrative fee that gets deducted from what the typical, and I forget what that percentage is. It's a couple percent, 2%?
It's 2%.
98%. The State Board of Ed, by decision years ago, upheld by the Court of Appeals, allows the locals to deduct 2% from the per pupil expenditure, Dr. Anderson. So they get 98% of what our per pupil expenditure is per student.
And that's to cover our administrative costs of supervision, approval of contract staff, our issuing of paychecks, W-2 forms, other kinds of services they brought that we provide to employees that are our employees but of that school.
Certification.
Personnel services.
Yeah, I guess what would it concern me, the cost that we have per student is over $14,000 if we don't include pre-K. I think if we include pre-K, it goes down to about 13 some. And then the cost in the budget and has been, sort of over the years. And we have the cost per student in the charter schools being around $9,000 in the budget. And so I'm trying to understand that piece. And then when I read today, read in the agreement that the amount that we're giving, so to speak, per student is 8,000 some, then we're wanting to know why, what makes up the difference. And I'm getting a little understanding.
That's a fair question, Dr. Anderson. Okay, and so in the budget book, it shows a breakdown of how our budget office calculates what the per pupil allocation is for charter schools. Mm-hmm. So one of the things that they do is they back out restricted funds. So none of our charter schools are Title I schools, so they back out Title I and other restricted funds.
Oh, okay.
The other piece is, unlike in some other jurisdictions, we back out special education as well because we provide those services to the students. So we don't give them the dollar amount for special education. If there's a student in a charter school that has IEP that requires certain services, the school district provides those services. So that's why you see the fluctuation every year in what the annual per pupil allotment is that we give the charters for their
good.
Students.
I see that. Now, why is it that there is a difference in what we see per student in the agreement with the schools versus what we have in a budget per student?
It fluctuates every year. So we put into the agreement what it is for the coming school year, and then they recognize that every year it could change depending on what we get in our approved budget. Mm-hmm. So maybe one year it could be $8,995. The subsequent fiscal year it could be $9,022. It changes every year depending on what we get and the number of students that we have overall in the school system.
Okay, but what we have in the budget is a projection of what we expect to give to the charter schools.
But it's also based on what we think we're going to get from the state and from the county.
Yeah,
yes, ma'am.
But that's what we expect to
right.
get.
Okay. But they know that they could potentially get a different amount after we go through the reconciliation process.
Okay, I just wondered if there were any hidden costs that the schools don't get, but we incur, you know, so. But I don't know. And you're saying no. Maybe not.
I mean, you could argue that we probably incur more than the 2% administrative cost that the State Board has said that we can retain. But we would have to go back to the State Board and argue that.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Well, we did argue with the state for a higher offset than 2%. The state only allowed that under the decision, the 2%. Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
I have Mr. Valentine and then Ms. Mundy.
Quick question. Have all three of these schools reached, I guess, the previous version of IE annual progress over the last 3 years?
To my understanding, they have. These are schools that you renewed their charter applications at your November meeting.
Mm-hmm.
And so this is just the charter agreement that says, yes, you can operate for the next 3 years and what the terms are. And then I'll come back probably at your next meeting, at least for Morningside and for Excel, to renew their facility use agreements to align with their charter schools because they're in our buildings.
And these are K-8. Are any of these three looking to go to the high school level as well? And if so, what year do we envision them doing that?
Imagine Lincoln and Excel are two of our original charter schools, so they've been operating for about 9 years, and they've grown to K-8. They didn't start out as K-8. They added a grade every year until they got there. Morningside has only been operating for 3 years, so they haven't gotten to the full extension yet to the K-8. But as far as I know, there's been no discussion amongst those schools about moving to the high school.
Okay. And my question for Ms. Golson, under 6.01, I thought Dr. Anderson would ask this question, but is JCI an MBE?
No, it is not.
Okay, thanks.
Ms. Mundy.
Thank you, Dr. Eubanks. I just want to say it's my pleasure to vote tonight to approve these budget consent items. I've had the pleasure to meet with the great leadership at Imagine Morningside, under the leadership of Dr. Thompson, as well as Imagine Lincoln, under the leadership of Principal Goddard there. Great schools, great students, great staff. There's great things happening there. I did just want to follow up on your question regarding the expansion of Morningside to K-8. in the board action summary, it says that the expansion will eventually happen. Is there a timeline or do you have an idea? I know that the charter right now is 3-year expansion. Is it sometime within that 3 years or?
No, they won't reach eighth grade in the next 3 years. They started out as K-2, I think.
Right, and they're K-5 now.
Right, and so I guess maybe their last year they might reach the eighth grade, I think. But what they've been doing is adding one grade every year until they get to K-8. That's the Imagine model.
Okay, thank you.
All right, I see no other lights up, so I will call for Ms. Berkeley to call the roll.
Item 6.1 through 6.4, Budget Consent Agenda. Dr. Anderson?
Aye.
Mr. Burrows?
Aye.
Ms. Epps? Absent. Ms. Eubanks?
Aye.
Ms. Hernandez is absent. Ms. Jacobs?
Aye.
Dr. Kaufman?
Aye.
Ms. Mundy?
Yes.
Ms. Quinteros Grady?
Aye.
Mr. Valentine?
Aye.
Ms. Williams?
Aye.
Ms. Boston?
Aye.
Dr. Eubanks?
Aye.
Well,
thank you. That motion carries. We have no second readers. We'll move on to new business items. First readers, I yield the floor to Dr. Maxwell for an introduction of items 9.1 and 9.2 on the new business first readers.
Thank you, Dr. Eubanks. Items 9.1 and 9.2 are first readers, which do not require discussion. They are board policy 9354 regarding board members' vouchered reimbursements or expenses, and the Prince George's County Public Schools new vision, mission, and core values.
Ah, Dr. Maxwell, you're such the optimist.
I am an optimist.
Ms. Boston.
And I will refer to our attorney to get a ruling on this, but I would like to make a motion to move or discuss item 9.1 and 9.2 separately.
We'll discuss 9.1 and 9.2 separately. Let's take, without objection, we'll take 9.1 first. You want to make a motion on 9.1?
Yes, I would like to make a motion to amend 9354 to include a provision that credit cards will not be issued to board members moving forward.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Mr. Burrows, you want to speak, or was that for your second?
That was going to be my motion as well.
All right, okay. Ms. Jacobs.
I just want to say thank you, Ms. Boston. I'll be voting in favor of doing that. I would also say to Delegate Washington, it might be a good idea if he amend his bill to include all county issued credit cards.
Mr. Kaufman.
Thank you. I'll also be voting in favor, but I have a question for our council regarding when this would actually take effect and what impact that would have on existing credit cards, and whether that might require a friendly amendment to set a specific date that would be realistic.
What I would recommend to the board is if the amended language is approved, you will be bringing this back for second reader, and you'll have a policy review committee meeting in the interim. And I would suggest that the exact language relating to this, because it is correct, you should have a time certain in there, can be discussed. I'm not sure, you probably would need to find out from your internal auditor as far as the cards being issued and canceled and the end of the fiscal year or some other date makes sense. You probably can't determine that tonight, but I do think that the board could approve of the amendment that no credit cards will be issued, which would then trigger the policy review committee when you all have your meeting to further refine that language. And then when the policy is posted as a second reader, that additional language will be included for review by the public and a final vote.
And just for clarity on that too, the board office, I will ask for clarity on that as well as the internal auditor. And significant changes in board office procedures have already been implemented. And I would imagine that that this can be done in relative short order with very little impact, if any, to the board at all. But we will bring those specifics to the committee at its next meeting. Mr. Valentine and Ms. Boston. Ms. Boston.
I just want to speak on my motion, and I definitely want to make sure that it's clear that I've definitely agreed with Ms. Jacobs when she made her statement earlier that it's important that we move forward with this work and not have this to be an issue. There's no omission that we did anything wrong. I think we legally followed our procedures with the usage of the credit card. It's just that we need to move forward, and we need to make sure that this is just off the table so we can do the work that we need to do.
Mr. Taylor.
As a board member who does not have access to a credit card, I would just like to commend my colleagues for making this step and this motion toward giving up that option. I really did agree with what was said about how the media shaped the perception of the board toward the credit cards instead of the great things that really happen in this county. So I would really like to commend every colleague who is in support of this, and thank you for helping move this county forward.
Thank you. And let me point out, too, that I think that doing this is the absolute right thing to do. I always have, regardless of any media, and I think it's significantly worth pointing out that media coverage, particularly that pointed out certain board members, I believe was done disingenuously and unfairly without a question, but it doesn't change the fact that I think we're doing, aside from any of that, we would be doing the absolutely right thing to do for the fidelity of the work that we do, because we don't need them, and because it's the public has these high expectations of us. Any other comments? All right, let's call the roll.
I'm getting ready to say that right now. A motion to include a provision in board policy 9354 that no credit cards be issued to board members. Yes? Wonderful. Dr. Anderson?
Aye.
Mr. Burroughs?
Aye.
Ms. Epps is absent. Ms. Eubanks?
Aye.
Ms. Hernandez is absent. Ms. Jacobs?
Absolutely.
Dr. Kaufman?
Aye.
Ms. Mundy?
Aye.
Ms. Quintero-Scurrity?
Aye.
Mr. Valentine?
Yes.
Ms. Williams?
Aye.
Mr. Taylor?
Aye.
Ms. Boston?
Aye.
Dr. Eubanks?
Aye.
12 ayes.
Thank you. That motion carries. We move on to item 9.2.
No, I'm sorry.
We don't move on to item 9.2. We go back.
Go back and approve it as amended, as a first reading.
Okay. We're now approving item 9.1. Can I just do them both together now? No? No. You don't let me do anything, Abby. We're approving item 9.1 as amended. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed? That motion carries. We're moving on to 9.1, Prince George's County Public Schools, 9.2. Jeez, come on, it's like 9:35 at night. I'm getting a little punchy. Our mission, vision, and core values, which if you haven't read them, and we're not supposed to talk about it, now this is some good work. This is what our work is all about. This is what our focus, and I want to thank everyone for the time, energy, and effort we put in to, from the administration, from the board, to really focusing on what our long-term vision is and how we want to work to make this county great. And so is there any discussion on that? Seeing none, all those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, that motion carries. Follow-up items are from January 8, 2015, board meeting, and January 20, 2015 will be on board docs when they become available. Colleagues, I'll entertain a motion to accept actions taken in executive session on Thursday, January 22, 2015.
So moved.
It's been moved and seconded that the Board of Education hereby approves actions taken in executive session on January 22, 2015 and are as follows: legal matters, administrative matters, personnel appointments. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, that motion carries. Colleagues, may I have a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Ladies and gentlemen, we are adjourned. Have a great evening.